Hello friends and welcome to the YouTube channel of DBL Education Private Limited, where we help you upskill yourself every day by adding a little bit of value. And today we're going to be talking about productivity metrics. This is the latest video in our module that gets you started on your startup journey. And productivity metrics are very important because they allow you to gauge how your product is doing in the market. Productivity metrics are physical measurements of the success of your product in the market. As a result, they are also known as KPI or Key Performance Indicators. Today, I'm going to introduce you to 12 of these indicators that you can use to tell how well your product is going to do. Number 1. Sales Revenue. This is the most basic and also the most important. Total income from sales over a period of time. This could be a week, a month, or a year. Just the total amount of income that you get from selling your product. Second, Net Profit Margin. Sales revenue minus your production cost. This is also pretty simple. The amount of money that it takes for you to produce your product in the factories, to create it, to get all the materials, you take that and that is subtracted from the sales revenue that you get. Now the third is interesting. It is gross margin. Net profit margin divided by the total sales revenue. So what you do here is the amount of money that you make net, which is basically profit minus loss, gets divided by your total revenue. This will allow you to get an average of the amount of money that you get or the amount of money that you make per rupee. Next, sales growth over time. This is the number of new deals that you make over a certain period. Now, this can also be a very interesting metric because your growth will depend over time. Now, if you want a very consistent look, you can look at it yearly. But if you want a more specific look, you have to look at it over a number of weeks or a number of months to inspect how well a certain change you might have made in your marketing or in your production might have resulted. Now this of course varies with the amount of the product that you're selling and with the kind of product that you're selling. If you're selling winter wear, for example, you're not going to experience much sales growth in summer. If you sell technology that is good all around the year, then obviously you can experience more consistent growth. But again, this depends. For instance, if you're selling something that was related to communication, it might have experienced an uptick during the pandemic time. If you're selling something related to entertainment, it might go up or down depending on the social circumstances and how much free time people have. So on this basis, inspecting your sales growth over a period of time can lead to different results. Fifth, cost of customer acquisition. Now this is important. It is the total cost of marketing in a certain period divided by the new customers you have acquired during this period. It will allow you to tell how many new customers you can get with a certain marketing strategy and whether or not that marketing strategy is viable and profitable. Customer lifetime value, now this is important, the number of repeated transactions divided by the cost of acquisition. If you have an X number of repeated transactions divided by a cost of acquisition, you can tell what is your customer's lifetime value. Now this is obviously not the value that they will give you for their entire life. Lifetime here means value over a certain month or over a certain period, assuming that said values are consistent. How do you know if your company is profitable? If you can get customers to consistently and repeatedly buy your products and the amount of value that you get from these repeated transactions is much greater than the cost that you spent to acquire them. So basically, to give you a metaphor, it's like if you spent 15 minutes fishing and caught something that could feed your family for a week. That is customer lifetime value. Customer retention or loyalty rate. Now this is important from a long-term perspective. You take your total customers and from that you subtract your number of new customers. What you get as a result of that, you divide by the number of customers at the start of your time period and you multiply the whole thing by 100. Now it sounds complicated, but the main idea here is to figure out if you take your total number of customers minus the amount of new customers that you get, which will give you what the number of old customers that you had. And if you divide that by your original customers, you'll figure out how many customers have left in this time period. If you have a high retention or loyalty rate, you'll have a good product market fit, which basically means that the consumers will love your product and be quite attached to it. Next, your net promoter score. Use surveys to rank your customer behavior from 1 to 10. Basically, just distribute these forms out to people and ask them to rank their behavior. Now, if people rank your product upwards of 9, then they are promoters. They love your product so much, they will talk to it to their friends and family and they will actually make your product more popular. They will sell your product for you. People who rate your product 7 and upwards are passives. Now, these are people who give your product ratings in the range of 7 to 9, which is basically a very nice rating that doesn't exactly say much. These are passives because they are not passionate about your product. It is convenient for them, but if a better product came up, they are not going to stick around. Work on improving them because you don't have to work very hard to turn a passive into a loyalist as long as you have the right strategy. Now, anyone who gives your product a rating from 0 to 6 is dissatisfied. They either dislike your product, have a low opinion of it, or actively have problems with your product. And listening to these people is extremely important. Because just as your promoters will sell your product for you, dissatisfied customers will destroy your sales. Qualified leads per month. The number of leads that match your expectations and goals. What are leads? Leads is a term used in sales. These are basically potential customers who could turn into contributors to your sales. So your qualified leads are basically the amount of leads that are determined based by your marketing department based on your expectations. So let's say you are creating a product that is marketed towards a certain segment of the middle class, like trendy teens in colleges. These will be your qualified leads. You'll have to figure out based on social media metrics how many of these people your qualified leads will reach. And once you've figured out how many of these people are going to buy your product or hear about it in the future, you will have your number of qualified leads per month. Then there is the lead to client conversion rate. Your new leads per month divided by the new customers. Now, just because someone is a lead doesn't mean that they're a customer. They could be people who might be potentially interested in buying your product. They could be people who are in the exact zone that your product appeals to. But if your value proposition is not that great to them, if there is another product in a similar or better price range that works for them, or simply if they're emotionally attached to a certain product and don't want to switch over to your product, you can't directly convert them into clients. So just because you have a lead doesn't mean you have a client. But if you have a good lead to client conversion rate, it proves that you are consistently able to figure out the amount of people that will buy your product and expand, which gives you a good chance at expanding into new markets and upscaling. Number of milestones met. Understand your own progress and revise expectations. Now, milestones are something that every company sets for themselves. These could be deadlines, these could be business goals, these could be sales goals. Now, regardless of the milestones, you need to figure out whether or not you are regularly meeting your milestones. If you constantly meet your milestones, it is good, but it could also suggest that you're setting your milestones too low and you should try harder. However, if you never meet any of your milestones, it either means that there is some problem with your company or that you are setting your expectations too high and you need to slow down and consolidate first. The first part of succeeding in the startup business is understanding your own capacities and your limitations. And lastly, employee satisfaction. Conduct surveys and collect suggestions for a good workspace. Make sure that your employees are satisfied. Make sure they feel like they are valued, that their suggestions are taken. If you don't have good employee satisfaction, nothing is going to work. It will be like a plant that is rotten from the roots. So make sure your employees are always satisfied. And through all these metrics, you can establish a good productivity metric and establish a good successful startup company. That is all for this video. Please don't forget to like, share and subscribe. Have any doubts, any inquiries, spell them out in the comments. Remember that TBL Education wants to help all the innovators in the world. Thank you very much.